السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. My beloved brothers and sisters, you can see I'm smiling because this is the first open air session that we're having dealing with this beautiful topic, the blessings in life. And at a time when we've all been through so much and we've become accustomed to a very different type of a life due to the pandemic that has overtaken the globe, it's important that we count our blessings. Many people have had lots of negativity in their lives, but when we have a session like this, and I'm very thankful to the Islamic Affairs Department and the government of the UAE for making it possible for us to meet today in this beautiful weather, discussing such an important topic. So alhamdulillah, when we have these hardships, we must talk to each other. We must put things into focus and take a page from what the Almighty has revealed to us. So at the outset, I want to say, my brothers and sisters, why did Allah make us? That's a question. Why were we created? Why did we come onto this earth? I wouldn't know unless I looked into Revelation. I would never be able to tell why did whoever made me make me and put me onto this earth where it is full of negativity all around. And it is full of hardship and challenges and one test after another. So let me look at Revelation to see what the Almighty, who we as believers believe made us, is saying to us regarding having made us. Do I sound a bit too technical? In all honesty, Allah Almighty says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created mankind or jinnkind except so that they worship me. When I was younger, I thought to myself without much knowledge that that sounded very dry. Dry meaning, as a young person without much knowledge, if someone were to tell you Allah made you to worship Him, you would say, but why? I mean, what did He need to do that for? What was the whole purpose? So the question is not in order to defy Allah, never, but just to know more. You know, when something happens to you that's negative, are you allowed to say, why me? You know, when you've lost a job, you've lost a loved one, you've lost two loved ones, you've lost your wealth, your factory's burnt down, everything's happened that's negative. Are you allowed as a believer to say, why is this happening? Well, the answer is, it depends why you're asking the question. If you're asking the question in order to learn more, then it's okay. It's fine to say, why is this happening to me? Do I need to adjust something? Is there something wrong in the way I'm doing things? Is there something wrong with, you know, do I need to really change? If that's the reason why you're asking, why is it happening to me? It's fine. Because you might find you've wronged someone. You might find you've done something very bad and some things are coming back to you in order for you to pay the price of what you've done. Maybe, maybe. But if you're saying, why is this happening to me? Why is Allah doing this to me? Defying the Maker or being upset and angry with Him, then we would tell you, my brother, my sister, you need a little bit of help to put things into focus and perspective as a believer. Because nothing negative that happens to a believer is actually negative in the long term. It's only short-term negativity. If you take it in your stride, you will find long-term benefit. But the question is when? You know, when coronavirus had hit initially, many people thought, well, this is just a few months. This is not that bad. This is just going to last maybe a year. We're getting close on to 2 years and things don't seem to have subsided much. And as they were subsiding a little, we found someone cry foul once again. And here we are with the world threatening to get back to where we were last year. Hopefully not. May Allah protect all of us. Say Ameen. May Allah protect us. Ameen, Ameen. So these things that appear to be very negative, in actual fact, when we look at why we were created and what Allah promised us, we start getting a few answers and we start seeing things from a different angle. And that's why we're talking about the blessings in life. You were created and so was I. The Almighty says to worship me. I need to look back into the book and find out more detail. To worship me is just in brief. But what is that worship? What does it entail? Well, Allah Almighty explains to us in many places in the Quran the details of the tests of life. And that would prove to us that He's created us in order to test us. Through those tests, we begin to worship Him in a holistic way that would not only solve our problems, but grant us contentment in this world and success together with contentment in the hereafter. So if I have something really bad that happened to me and I look at it from the angle that Allah wants me to look at it, I'll nod my head and it'll be made a little bit easier for me. Although the same problem happening to someone who doesn't believe in anything at all or who has a very loose relationship with Allah, a very small or should I say weak relationship with Allah, in that particular case, one would be going through the same issue with a smile and the other one would be going through an issue half the size of the first, but with double the stress because they don't know how to look at it. That's Allah. So Allah tells us, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ. Oh, Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah says, right at the beginning, meaning it's the first, the second surah of the Quran, the first Surah Al-Fatiha, then Surah Al-Baqarah. Allah says, we will definitely test you. Linguistically, the term lanabluwanna is actually emphasized twice to say, we will indeed most definitely test all of you. You're going to test me. Subhanallah. Well, now I know something. Allah says, we created you. We want you to get to the other side of this life, which will be the eternal life. And we want you in the interim to recognize us, to worship us, to understand where we, what position we hold in your life. And then you get to us, you meet us, and we will give you an eternal paradise. Now, if I were to ask, well, oh Allah, did you really need to do this? The answer is obviously Allah doesn't need to do anything. He does it because He wants to. He wishes to. I don't have a say. Evidence of it is that you and I were born without you and I having a say. Did you say, I want to be born? No. Did you say, I want to be born in this part of the world or that part of the world? No. Allah chose it. I'm here. Now that I'm here, I have no option. I didn't have an option at the beginning. How could I have an option now? Subhanallah. I just need to look after this life, respect everyone else, because whoever made me made all the other people, and their lives are as sacred as mine. So I'm going to look after them. I'm going to make sure I don't harm them. In the meantime, I'm going to worship the one who made me. So if Allah guides you to worshiping Him, because you recognize that you need to worship He who made you, that is the biggest single blessing you could ever have. The biggest single blessing you can ever have is guidance from Allah. When you're guided to worship the one who made you and you say, oh, you who made me, you are the only one worthy of worship, you are blessed. You are blessed. Evidence of this again, Surah Al-Fatiha, we read it every day in prayer. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm al-Din, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in, Ihdina al-Sirat al-Mustaqim. That's the prayer. So this is Surah Al-Fatiha, the opening chapter of the Quran. And we are saying in it, guide us to the straight path, which means guidance is the most important gift you could ever have. The blessing that Allah has bestowed upon you, the biggest of all is guidance. If you're guided, then trust me, you have the greatest blessing. And this is why when the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, told the people what was right and wrong, And when the previous messengers told their followers what was right and wrong, it became clear that there are two types of guidance. One is guidance as in knowing the path. And two is guidance as in treading the path. Two types of guidance. One is ad-dalala wal-irshad, to be able to recognize this is the path, this is the road, this is the way, this is what's right, this is what's wrong. To recognize that is guidance. But to walk on it and to be able to act upon it and to live by it is the actual guidance through which you will enter paradise. So for you and I to know what's right and wrong is not as difficult as it is than to tread the path. Treading the path is far more difficult. May Allah make easy for us both. But once you recognize the first, you're already being blessed by Allah. Now you need to fight your soul to make sure you're doing the right thing. What's halal, what's haram is not even my topic, because we all know most of what is halal and haram, if not almost everything. You know. If I tell you, draw up a list of what's haram, even the non-Muslims who know a little bit about Islam will tell you 5 or 6 things. You're not allowed to do this, you're not allowed to do that, you're not allowed to do that. It means the guidance is there, but to walk on it, that's what we need. Al-hidayah, that's what we need. At-tawfiq, we need the acceptance from Allah to be able to walk on it. My brothers, my sisters, the Almighty created us. Like I said, He didn't need to, but He did it. We found ourselves here. Recognize your Maker. Worship Him alone. I was speaking to a young boy who told me, prove to me that Islam is correct. Prove to me that I need to worship someone, something. I thought for a moment and then I said, how old are you? He said, 11. Where were you 12 years ago? He says, well, I don't know. Where was I 12 years ago? So I said to him, well, 12 years ago you were with the Almighty. Wherever you were, whoever was in charge there, all you have to do right now is to say, oh, you who had me 12 years ago, you are the greatest. Are you ready to say that? He says, yeah. I said, well, that's all you need to say. Oh, you whom I was with 12 years ago, I worship you alone. And when I return to you, I want you to have mercy on me. I said, you know what? Already you have the concept of oneness in your mind, if you know that and you understand that. Because if you know that your mind cannot explain to you where you were, for example, 12, 13, 15 years ago, when you're just 11 years old, and you're prepared to say, wherever I was, whoever was there, in control of everything, He is my Maker. He is the one whom I owe worship to. Hence, we have the term Allah that refers to the Almighty who made you. The worshipped one, who is the only one who is owed worship. And that term, subhanAllah, it's a name that Allah has given Himself in the Hebrew language. And I've said this before. Elohim or Eloha is the exact as Allah. Right? It's referring to the worshipped one. God Almighty. He alone we worship, the Maker, the Nourisher, the Cherisher, the Sustainer, the Provider, the Protector, the Curer, the one in whose hands lies absolute control of every aspect of existence. And we've repeated this so many times, but it's so true, because He is in charge. As sophisticated as I am, He keeps showing us that you know very little, very little. I mean, look at this pandemic. You can't see it. People haven't really fully understood it. They say the new variant, may Allah protect us all from it, say Ameen. They say we don't know much about it, but the little we know about it, XYZ. That statement is already enough to show there is a greater power. There is a greater power. He is showing you something. As sophisticated as you are, as advanced as technology and medicine might be, there is still a long way for you to go before you'll understand a little bit of some of the things that Allah wants to show you and to teach you. And every time you see things and every time you discover things, they will lead you towards this Maker. So the biggest blessing is when you recognize your maker. The biggest blessing is when he has guided you in that direction. Subhanallah. So keep asking Allah for it. 17 times a day. If you pray 5 times a day, minimum 17 times a day, you are saying, "Oh Allah, oh Allah, guide me to the straight path." Because it's the most important supplication you could ever supplicate by. Guide me to the straight path. Now, thereafter, you're guided to the straight path. There are so many other blessings that we should be looking into and considering a blessing. Because shaitan, the devil, comes to us and only makes us look at positives. You have a lot of money, they say, "I'm blessed." Have you heard that? "I'm blessed." You have many kids, they say, "I'm blessed." You have a good job, "I'm blessed." You have everything cruising for you, "I'm blessed." MashaAllah. Yes, those are blessings. But tonight I want to talk about blessings that are hidden in something you think is totally negative. Totally negative. You lost a job. Are you going to say, "I'm blessed," with a smile? If you can, you're a believer. Haven't you heard me say, and haven't you heard us as Muslims teach, that if things go your way, say Alhamdulillah. And if things do not go your way, what do you say? Alhamdulillah twice. Because they've gone the way Allah wants them to go. He has something bigger planned for you. It may happen right now. It may happen in a year, 2 years, 5 years, or whenever. But it's coming. Have faith. عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ فَإِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٌ. Amazing are the affairs of a true believer. For indeed, every single affair of the believer is positive. Never negative. Why? Because that's why you're patient if something bad happens, because you know it's temporary and it's a door to something big. Something very big. Moments ago, I said, you lost a job. Are you ready to say, Alhamdulillah, what a great blessing? No, we are weak. We are human. It's very tough for us to say that because I need the money right now to pay my rent and my food and my this and my that. And I need everything. I needed the job. And look at this. I just lost it. Hang on. Don't be depressed. Say Alhamdulillah. Praise Allah. Continue doing good. Worship Him. Have hope in Him. Keep on trying and don't ever give up. Don't ever give up. No matter what. The day you give up, that's the day you will suffer the loss. If you don't give up, even if you lost everything, trust me, there was a time in your life when you had nothing anyway. It's okay. We will start again. We will get up. And I'm not going to lose. So what's the first blessing in that negativity of the loss of the job? Can I tell it to you? As a believer, you become closer to your maker. That's the first blessing. Something just happened so negative. You went through a divorce and you got to say, Alhamdulillah, oh Allah, I thank you for this blessing. Well, I think some people might actually consider it a blessing based on how bad life was. But still, no matter what it is, it's a tough situation. It's not nice to go through things that the public looks at as very negative. So at times even that. But we have to say, Alhamdulillah, all praise is due to Allah. This is such a great blessing. And then what you do, you got to actively pray to the Almighty. So it brought you closer to Allah. Look at the hidden blessing. Anything that brought you close to your maker is positive and it's a blessing, even if it seemed like it was the greatest negativity in terms of the worldly life. You lost a loved one, it brought you close to Allah. That was a blessing. What was the blessing? The blessing was the fact that it took that to bring you close to Allah. When the pandemic struck, I know of people who, as they were tested positive, immediately they started asking forgiveness from people. And it's not a joke. It was good for them to do that. They started saying, "Look, I might not make it. I might make it." And then we had to say, "Listen, you will make it, inshallah." Because sometimes it's the negative mind that actually kills you, not necessarily the condition. Your mind is a powerful tool. Be positive. You will make it. You will do it. You are going to come out of this. And it's just a matter of time. People lost their jobs. The same companies called them back a year later, 2 years later. But they were almost dead in those 1.5 years. Relax. These days, they will go through. Some are positive and some are negative. But for a believer, it's a blessing in the negativity. So you say, oh Allah, I thank you. You get up, you pray, you cry. Allah says, I'm going to delay you because I need tears to roll. So you haven't yet cried. So Allah says, wait, pray again. You pray again, a week later, a month later. Then this one is asking for their payment. The other one is asking for something. Your rent is due. You can't afford food. And one day you break down in tears. And Allah says, I was waiting for this. What blessing is it? Tears rolling down your eyes are the means of your entry into paradise. You become a VIP when you remember Allah and your eyes are filled with the tears only. رَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. For someone who remembers Allah and their eyes are filled with tears, that is such a great blessing that you're called on the Day of Judgment to a separate, unique place. Imagine when those tears roll down the cheeks. What a blessing is that? Allah says, you finally cried. Oh, subhanAllah, you don't miss a prayer. You've improved on everything. You've sought the forgiveness of Allah. Your dress code, everything has improved. And mashallah, what a great blessing. If it took the loss of a job for you to get to this level of closeness with Allah, I promise you, it's a blessing. Nobody looks at it that way. Then you keep trying. You apply here for a job. You apply there for a job. You go back there. You try and get some training done. You do something positive during these days that you might be slightly free. You make sure you learn Quran. Perhaps you join a course. You increase your knowledge. And you keep applying and continue. And one day you will get a job offer far beyond what you imagined. And then when you're sitting in the new position, and trust me, I have people whom I've spoken to and addressed and people whom I've interacted with and helped who have confirmed this. Not one, but many of them. They say, now that I'm sitting in my new job, I can't thank Allah enough. It is way beyond. The pay is better. The hours are easier. There's more respect around me. There's this and there's that. And where I was, when I lost it, I cried so much and I was like, my world has come to an end. I know people who've lost in business. Trust me, the biggest blessing is that it should bring you closer to Allah. You're a believer. Sometimes people resort to alcohol, perhaps. They resort to intoxicants in other parts of the world. But we are believers. We don't do that. We continue to turn to Allah. Pray. Don't lose hope. Allah says, never lose hope. No way. Losing hope is not in my dictionary. It shouldn't be in yours. That's the blessing that Allah has bestowed upon us. And then Allah opens the doors in a way that you can't imagine. That is a blessing in what we looked at as negative. Sometimes you go through a health matter. Good health, we say, I'm blessed. Sometimes when you're diagnosed something that is negative, there could be a blessing in it for you. Because Allah will open other doors. I remember a brother, this is a true story that happened. A brother suffered with an appendicitis and it's a procedure, it's quite common. And he happened to go to the hospital and on his way, he called me and he says, Sheikh, please pray. You know, I'm going to this hospital and I said, look, it's just a procedure. You're lucky that they caught it in time. And inshallah, everything will be okay. But you know, when you pray for yourself, that's also very, very powerful because you're broken to the degree where you're helpless. And Allah loves it when you admit your helplessness and the power of Allah. When you say, oh Allah, who am I? I'm nothing. I can't even do anything without your help and your power. Oh Allah, who am I? I don't have the means to achieve what I need to. Only with your help I'll be able to achieve X, Y, and Z. Allah loves it because He knows. He is the one. He'll give you the power. He will give you the energy. He will grant you the acceptance. So the brother, he says to me, I said, inshallah, just say Alhamdulillah. Say Alhamdulillah and pray to Allah. You pray. He says, but you know, what could there be good in this for me? I said, I don't know either. I don't know the future. I know nothing. Anyway, he went to the hospital, and because it's a true story, I'm going to tell it to you. In no way am I saying you this should happen when you go to the hospital, but it's just a story. You're going to hear it. So he says, sometime later, about 6 months later, he says, Sheikh, I'm getting married. I said, oh, wow, mashallah. I said, to who? He says, to one of the nurses who treated me when I went for the
I said, Subhanallah, Allah drove you all the way to that place to meet your better half. Imagine. How did it happen? He says, Wallahi, I don't know. Don't even ask me. He says, I really don't know. And I was like, well, yeah, Subhanallah. One day I'm going to talk about this and tell the public, look, he went for something, not realizing Allah's giving him something else. Musa alayhi salam, إِذْ رَآ نَارًا فَقَالَ لِأَهْلِهِمْ كُثُوا إِنِّي آنَسْتُ نَارًا. Musa alayhi salam, the Prophet Moses, may peace be upon him, when he saw the fire at a distance, he decided to tell his family, hang on, I'm just going to get a bit of light and I'm coming. I'm going to get a bit of this warmth and I'm coming. Not realizing he's going to get one thing. But when he got there, he got prophethood and came back. Subhanallah. He got prophethood and he came back. So sometimes something that appears very negative is actually a positive. Sometimes you don't know, why did Allah make me go to a certain place? Why did Allah make me meet a certain place, a certain person? Sometimes it's because they might do something bad to you that later on might result in you bearing patience, and through patience you will get paradise. What's your ultimate goal? Mine is paradise. Yours should be paradise. So you meet a person at work, or you get married to a person, for example, who's not a good person. It can happen. It does happen. And you're struggling maybe because of whoever it might be. The fact that you bear patience itself is a blessing. Do you know why? You might be struggling. You might be going through a lot. You might think, no way, I can't manage. Allah says, إِنَّمَا يُوَفَّى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Indeed, the reward of those who bear patience is unlimited. So, if I want to bear patience, I need to have a negative thing that happens to me to engage in an act of worship known as sabr. Had it not been for that negativity, I wouldn't be able to bear patience. So Allah says, I want you to achieve a great reward. There is a blessing in it, because you're only going to live for 50 years or 60 or more or less. And then you're going to come to me. But the fact that you were patient every moment that you were in that condition was a reward. People who are terminally ill, sometimes they say, well, what's the blessing in here? The blessing is Allah says clearly, it expiates your sins if you are patient. It elevates your status if you are patient. And ultimately we give you paradise because of your patience. So much so that when the sick and ill person gets to the day of judgment, he may say, oh my Lord, why didn't you keep me sick for a longer time? Perhaps I would have earned a greater reward just by the time ticking, because I was patient. These are blessings. Blessings that we take for granted. In my life, everything is a blessing. In your lives, everything is a blessing. Even if it appears to be something negative. You made an accident, for example, on the road. May Allah protect us. Two cars bashed into each other. What do we say? Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. We belong to Allah, all of us, and ultimately we're going to return to Him. That prayer is supposed to put things into focus for you to say, don't become too upset. It's worldly items. This is a worldly item. Your car can be replaced. Everything else can happen. Subhanallah. If you've broken a limb, thank Allah. It's a blessing. How is it a blessing? Are you foolish? No, I'm not. You could have broken two limbs. You only broke one. That's the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, telling us, when something bad has happened, look at those who are in a worse condition than you. Don't look at those above you, because you won't be able to see the blessing. You only have one jacket. Your friend has 10 jackets. And you're so upset and you feel, wow, imagine Allah hasn't given me what? The 9 other jackets Allah didn't give me. But my brother, are you forgetting you have one? You need to go and see those who don't even have clothes to appreciate the fact, oh Allah, the fact that I have one jacket is a blessing. But you won't ever appreciate that, because you keep looking at those who have more. And this brings me to social media. When Corona struck, one of the biggest blessings that we've come up with or we've realized is the online life. Social media and the internet being used to a degree that it wasn't before. Don't you agree? We didn't know, or even if we knew at the back of our minds, but we didn't make use of it to this degree. Every day, life is being made easier and easier. And all this was suddenly expanded because of what happened. We all had to sit at home, and because we were sitting at home, we were forced to use some online application, and one app and another, and we had to zoom from here to there, and we had to do this and that, and subhanAllah, it's opened up such a big blessing. The internet is a great blessing if used correctly. Social media is a great blessing if used correctly. Subhanallah. So when the pandemic struck, one of the big favors of Allah that came out of all of this is technology and the advancement. Imagine if this had struck in 1980 and we were all living in 1980. I think we wouldn't be as sane as we are today, because it would be very difficult to have stayed indoors at the time when there was a proper lockdown and no one was allowed to come out. It was not going to be so easy. But here, we knew what was happening. We were communicating with everyone. We had video calls. We had audio calls. But did anyone ever thank Allah, or were they only looking at the fact that, you know what, we can't come out? You can't come out is one negative, but there were another 1,000 positives, subhanAllah. You can't come out, but you have internet that they didn't have. You have video calling they didn't have. You can talk, you can order online, they couldn't do it. You can do so much, they couldn't do it. But they used to thank Allah for what? For what? They used to thank Allah for things that you don't have. And they used to thank Allah for things that you have that they didn't even dream of. You follow what I'm saying? I always sit and look at the life of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and I say, subhanAllah, Allah loved him the most indeed. Yet, there were no taps with running water. No geysers that you could just turn on a tap and hot water's coming out. I went to one of the countries, a third world country, and when I entered the bathroom, I turned on the tap and there was no hot water. But the cold water was trickling. It wasn't cold, it was warm. It was like room temperature, should I say. And as it's trickling, I was just saying, Alhamdulillah, subhanAllah, at least we have some water. MashaAllah, tabarakallah, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah. A little while later, a guy comes in with a bucket full of water. He says, Sheikh, I filled this water. I said, oh wow, subhanAllah, I already had this thing trickling and half a bucket's already full. He says, no, I brought this water. I said, Alhamdulillah, subhanAllah, look at this. And in my mind, I'm thinking, myself, a few years ago, I would have complained and said, look at this, there's no water here, man, what's going on? But you realize at a certain point that the droplets are really a favor of Allah. Back in my country, the water can go for a week, 2 weeks. No water from the taps. The electricity can go for a week, 2 weeks, no sign of it back in my country. And the day it comes back for 2 hours, it's like this is Eid. I wouldn't mind saying Eid Mubarak, my brother. You know, because subhanAllah, it's so beautiful. You see these lights again, mashallah. And when the water comes, hey guys, the water's back, mashallah. Look, 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 look. It's trickling down, it's coming. And you're so excited about the trickle. But with us, we are used to a shower that has to come down at a certain pressure, and we are used to a bed that is so beautiful with 500 thread count cotton or more, and we cannot do with any less than that. If there is anything less than that, we are just cursing everyone and everything around us. That's not how a believer should operate. That's why sometimes in our luxury lives, we tend to not appreciate the blessings of Allah because we haven't recognized them. And when Allah speaks of the blessings, you know what He says in the Quran? وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. If you make an effort to count the favors of Allah. Allah didn't say the favors of Allah are limitless. He didn't say that. The favors of Allah are not countable. He didn't say that. He said, if you count them, which means you need to make an effort in order to recognize that, yes, this is a gift, this is a gift, this is a gift. That's the meaning of wa in ta'uddu. Allah could have worded it in any other way. Allah says, if you count them, then you will realize, la tuhsuha, you won't be able to count all of them. That's the beauty of the Quran. Go out and count your blessings. Find them, look for them. Whenever something happens to you, no matter what it is, just say Alhamdulillah, start looking at it, start thinking about it, and check all the angles, look at those who have less, look at others, and then take it in your stride. Don't lose hope. Get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Strive towards what is going to benefit you. And what that means is, if it's a job, you keep on looking for another one. If it's a marriage that broke down, you try again, no problem. It's okay. Even if you went through two or three marriages and they didn't work, you keep trying. You don't give up. You keep trying and you keep going, and Allah will open the doors. And subhanallah, once all of that happens, you must just thank Allah and say, oh Allah, today I'm a much better person. I'm a much, much better person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. Another blessing and a favor that I must speak about when we talk about the blessings in life. Your family. Allah chose them for you. Muslim or not Muslim. Practicing or not practicing. Good or bad. Allah chose them for you. They are a test and they are a blessing. Two ways. Because if they are good and kind, mashallah, it is very important to have a circle around you of people who care for you in a way that is unlimited. What that means is, something happens to you, immediately there must be a circle of people around you. Mostly Allah creates this within family members. Mostly. There are some exceptions and I'll perhaps get to that. But mostly when you have a circle of people around you who care for you, how are you? Is everything okay? I'm coming. I'll be there just now. Or we're together in this. I'm going to help you. I'm going to do this and do that. That's a big blessing. But in order to have that circle around you, you need to be very tolerant and you need to be very forgiving and you need to be broad-minded in a certain way, because Allah did not create those people with your mind and your emotions. Even your father and your mother, those who are your parents and gave birth to you, they don't think the same and they don't have the same emotions. And they're not replicas of you. They probably would be similar in some ways, but very different in many other things. So in order to enjoy family, you need to be forgiving. You need to be accommodating. You need to be tolerant. And you need to sacrifice a little bit. If you're not prepared to sacrifice, how do you expect to enjoy the favors of a family unit? And when we say sacrifice, it's within a limit. Now, I was saying there are some exceptions. What are the exceptions? You have some people who are outright crazy. I had an email I received today. I read it and it's not the only one that has come on that subject, where they say, my father's abandoned us. He went off and he left and he doesn't want to know us. And now that I've grown older, I tried to go out to meet him and he's just kicked us away. He doesn't want to know who we are and he has nothing to do and it's bothering me and affecting me. What should I say to that child? I wish I had a moment to speak to the father of that child. It's your responsibility, your duty, no matter what, to reach out to your children, no matter what, and to speak to them, to communicate with them, to empower them. Children tend to grow up very quickly. And in those tender years, while they're growing up, they need words of love from their parents. They need words of reassurance. They need words of goodness and kindness. They need support. They need positivity. They need someone to talk to them and guide them. Moments ago, I was speaking to the teens and tweens. And what we did say is, don't feel bad when someone tells you, because someone needs to tell you. Another message that I received was when one of them said, I want to marry very far from our family because I want to marry into a community or into a culture that no one tells me anything and I don't want to be told a thing and I wouldn't like to anyone to interfere in my life in any way. And I said, my child, you need to be told things. Don't ever, as a believer, think that you should lead a life where no one's allowed to tell you anything, because then you'd lose your way. You would lose your way. Your parents are there to tell you. Your mother is there to nag at you. It's normal. It's natural. They want goodness. They want you to grow up in a beautiful way. They're going to tell you, don't do this and don't do that, and don't dress this way and don't dress that way. I remember a woman who, some years ago, who said, you know, when I was growing up and as I got married and so on, I used to dress quite provocatively. She's telling you herself. And she says, I didn't like to be told, but still I was a little bit afraid of my parents. So when my parents were around, I used to try, you know, to perhaps dress a little bit more modestly and so on. But now that I have my own child doing things that are way beyond what my imagination would have allowed me to do when I was growing up, I really can't tolerate this. I'm thinking to myself, look how the world is changing. Look how it's changing. You don't want to be told, it's fine. A day will come when you'll have children and you'll want to tell them, but they won't want you to tell them. And you know what's going to happen? They're going to be doing things that you consider totally absurd. I'll give you one quick example. Okay. A lot of you might recall your grandparents. We're not going beyond grandparents. A lot of you might recall your grandparents. Can you imagine your grandmother in a tights and a top walking down the street? Can you imagine? But can you imagine your daughter do that? Yeah, you can. Maybe a little kid. I'm not talking of adults, okay? But look how the world has changed. مَعْرُوفُ زَمَانِنَا مُنْكَرُ زَمَانٍ قَدْ مَطَى. What we consider normal today was considered totally taboo by people of the past. And what is considered taboo today will be considered normal by the people of tomorrow. So, what I'm trying to say is, don't feel bad when someone just tells you, look, I think you shouldn't do this. That's your mother. That's your father. They have a right to let you know. That's your spouse. I mean, your husband has to tell you and your wife has to tell you if you're a husband. Either way, listen, don't do this. It's not good. I don't like it, for example. Who are you? I'm your mother. I'm your father. Well, I don't want to be told. Well, let me give you a story. Then you can tell them this story. Today you don't want to be told. Tomorrow, what's going to happen? Are you prepared for your children to tell you the same thing? The answer is no. If you think about what's gone on, subhanallah. May Allah make it easy for all of us. So put things into perspective. It's a blessing when someone tells you, don't do this when you're wrong. Big blessing. Al-amru bil-ma'rufi wa-nahi anil-munkar. Those are blessings of Allah. If someone enjoins that which is good, when someone encourages you to fulfill your salah, someone encourages you to do a good deed, that's a favor of Allah. If you did it, that's a big blessing. Sometimes the blessings in your life are in the form of your friends. You have good friends and they are with you in goodness, blessing. May Allah make us good friends. People say, how can I be sure that my friends are good? And I say, by being a good friend. You be a good friend. Don't worry about this one and that one. Inshallah. And if they're having a bad impact on you, you need to unplug a little bit. Or you need to start being a bit stronger and telling them what's right and wrong. And then they might listen to you or they might sideline you. Either way, it's a blessing for you. You got the reward for it. My brothers, my sisters, these are some of the blessings of Allah. I said family, blessing. The fact that Allah has given us so much, blessing. Whenever you've been through a struggle, say for example, the weather across the globe at the moment is a little bit extreme. You know, call it global warming, call it whatever you want. But we notice, we who are not scientists, notice that there is a change in global weather. We find extreme sometimes when it rains, it pours. And sometimes when it's hot, it becomes so hot and so on. So these extremes, how do we look at them? Well, sometimes we may suffer a loss as a result of extreme weather. But I promise you a day will come when you'll come out of that. Allah will give you the means to come out of it. I've seen how people's homes have been wiped out in other countries. And we cannot cope, or we cannot accept that there was a little flood with some water that came into our lounge and messed up the carpet. Water came into your lounge and messed the carpet. You're more depressed than the people who lost their homes, who are sitting and saying, well, at least we have a shelter here. Until something is done for us, makeshift structure where we're staying. Look at it, we're spoilt. That's why we feel it more than others. So my brothers, my sisters, we ask Allah Almighty to grant us ease, goodness, and to open our doors. When I was told to speak about the blessings in life, I thought of so many things and I told myself, you know what? We've all been through a lot and we are still going through a lot. And the negativity is so much. But let's talk about the blessings within these negatives. And let's see how we need to look at things. Like I said earlier, something happens. Look at it from every angle. Look at it as a believer. You could ask, why did Allah do this? In order to learn something, not in order to defy Allah. So when you say, let me try and understand what Allah is doing here, you may not understand and you won't understand it in its entirety. But definitely, if you begin to thank Allah and you become closer to Him, a day will come when He will give you, that closure where you'll be able to see, okay, now I understand why what happened happened. Sometimes that might just be in the hereafter. But a lot of the times it's on earth. Look, I'll give you another example. You lose a child at an early age. That's one of the biggest challenges you could ever have as a parent. Nobody can soothe your heart besides Allah because they won't understand what you've been through and what you're going through. May Allah grant us paradise. You lose a child at an early age and you are asking yourself, why? And you're depressed and you're upset. Do you know Allah chose the time of death of that child in such a way that it was a blessing for you, although at the time it was negative because you did not see the rest of the age of that child. Had the child lived longer, perhaps the child may have not been such a good child as they were to that particular point. Where do I get this from? Surah Al-Kahf. You know about that young boy? When the question was asked about why did he have to die this way, the answer came. وَأَمَّا الْغُلَامُ فَكَانَ أَبَوَاهُ مُؤْمِنَيْنِ فَخَشِينَا أَن يُرْهِقَهُمَا طُغْيَانًا وَكُفْرًا فَأَرَدْنَا أَن يُبْدِلَهُمَا رَبُّهُمَا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُ زَكَاةً وَأَقْرَبَ رُحْمًا. Allah says it quite clearly. As for the child, he had blessed good parents. And we knew that if he were to live any longer, he would have been a disobedient child, bringing about a lot of negativity for his parents. So what we did, we took him away at an early age and perhaps we might give them another child. That was a blessing for the parents that they lost the child, but they don't know. I had a friend, much older than me, who's passed on, may Allah give him Jannah. He lost some of his family members. Later on, a few years later, he said, I wish I lost all my kids. I said, but why? He said, the others are on drugs and I'm suffering and I'm struggling and I really don't know what to do. And I said, subhanAllah, the day that he lost his earlier kids, he was so upset, and rightly so. We're human. We don't know the plan of Allah. But sometimes Allah shows us later, listen, I know what I did. Allah does not give you children because He doesn't want you to go through something that might be totally, you know, outside of your line of thinking. And it happened. So Allah will delay some people a few years before He gives them children. The delay is a blessing. You know, in the Arabic language, there's a saying, "Kul ta'khira fiha khira." Every delay, there is some goodness in it. You missed your flight, no stress. Again, with me, when I was a little bit younger, if something happened of that nature where you were late for something, I would get very upset. Now, no more, not at all. I just walk in, they say, well, you know, you missed the flight. I say, okay, let's catch the next one, mashallah. They look at you and think you're crazy, man. I say, yeah, I am. Look at things from a different angle. Allah did not want you on there, no problem. Not long ago, one of my flights, I actually, for some reason, I couldn't get on it. And the other guys who were with me who had the same problem and couldn't get on it were so angry and upset, and they're telling me, and I went to order some food and I started distributing it among some of the people and so on. They say, you look so happy. I said, hey, listen, imagine me sitting for so many hours next to a guy who's coughing and he had coronavirus and I end up getting it. To me, I was saved from it. I'm okay. They say, but you're mad. How do you know? Maybe it will happen with the next plan. I trust my Lord enough not to do it for me then. Good enough. Whether it was going to be or not going to be, wasn't it something that made me feel good? Well, that's what faith should do to you. Your faith should do that to you. Makes you feel good because that's what life is all about. Your life is not going to increase or decrease in terms of time because it's fixed by Allah. But the quality of your life will go up and down based on your faith and your conviction. If you have nothing but you have contentment, your quality of life is better than a person who has everything with no contentment. It's all about the quality of the few years you're going to be here. And that quality comes with faith. You need to develop your relation with the one who made you. We go back to that first gift of Allah, the blessing. So it's just amazing how Allah works in this beautiful way. May Allah Almighty grant us goodness. And may Allah open our doors. The weather is so beautiful, gift of Allah. Everything seems to be superb, gift of Allah. We're seated here, we're breathing, we were able to make it, gift of Allah. Even those who were unable to make it, gift of Allah. There is a link with this being beamed live, gift of Allah. Those who don't have internet right now, gift of Allah, it's going to be available tomorrow as well, mashallah. So it just goes on and on. But if you're going to get angry, oh, I wanted to do this, but I couldn't. Allah wants you somewhere, you're not going to be anywhere else. So I was saying, if Allah's delayed your marriage, if it didn't happen, for example, that doesn't mean stop trying. No, keep trying, because when you try, you get a reward for trying to do the right thing. I'm trying to achieve something. إِحْرِصْ عَلَى مَا يَنْفَعُكَ. You need to work hard towards achieving that which is beneficial for you. That's an ibadah, it's an act of worship. So I'm going to keep trying, but Allah knows whether it's going to happen or not. If it doesn't happen, I'm going to believe that Allah's protected me from someone who might have come into my life and turned it upside down. Speak to those who have been through that and they'll tell you, don't be in such a big rush. I'm not saying don't try. Please try. Keep trying. Keep meeting people and talking to them, interacting. People say, you know what, it's been... I'm this old and I don't know why, but I'm just not getting married. I say, do people know that you actually exist? That's question number one. If they don't, I mean, what do you expect? Come on. People have to know you're there. And that's why it's very important to interact physically with friends, with people, with families and so on. Very important. People today want to be in their own shell and they think, well, it's okay, me and my phone. That's it. You have a family function, I don't want to attend. You have a wedding, I don't want to go. You have this, I don't want to attend. You have something else, you're going to the marketplace, I don't want to go. Sometimes you must make sure you go because people need to interact with you in real life. That's why the Prophet ﷺ says, the one who interacts with others and bears patience regarding their negativity is better than the one who doesn't interact at all. Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Hadith. So you interact a little bit, you mix a little bit, you talk a little, let them know you. One day when someone once is looking for a husband, for example, they'll know, wow, this guy here or that person, I know they have a brother. What a lovely guy. Let's talk about it. But if they didn't know you existed, what will they say? So it's a blessing to have friends. It's a blessing to physically meet. The men folk Jumu'ah is compulsory upon you. One of the reasons is to get acquainted with one another, to know one another. Al-Jumu'atu wal-Jama'ah. Jama'ah means to gather and to come together. Why is it compulsory? If it wasn't so important, it's important because you go there, you greet each other, you take care of each other, you find out about each other, the health and the conditions of each other, and you can assist each other, and that's what the Jama'ah is there for. The group. The gathering. Today we are seated here. I promise you, there will be many of us. We came in, we sat next to people who... Subhanallah, our lives could change because we interacted with them and we didn't interact with them. And we went away without even knowing 5 new names of people who we didn't know before. Earlier, I came in and I walked into the office And one of the brothers came, served me tea. I had to ask him, what's your name? But there's a reason. Acknowledge that this is a human being, even though he might be someone who works or who's employed, or he's just a tea boy, for example. But he's an integral part of the success of the entire institution. So you greet him. Ask him, what's his name? Say it again and say, it's nice to meet you. Let him go away. What happened? He feels important. He feels a part of everyone. He feels, wow. And he is a human. It could have been the other way around. He could have been talking here today and I could have been the other side serving tea. It could have been. But just the greeting, what did you lose? It's a blessing of Allah to greet and to respond to a greeting, to get acquainted with people, to meet them. You may know, you may not know. I have seen little miracles in my own life with people whom I've greeted, not realizing Allah's created a solution for a problem that I'm going to be having, and the key, He's going to give a part of it to this particular person. And the only thing that happened is you just greeted them, Salaam Alaikum, how are you, my brother? Okay, I'm fine. That was all that happened. One day you say, oh, it's this guy here, mashallah. Hey, I met you somewhere, man. Familiar face. May Allah grant us goodness. So interact and greet today. Before you leave, please greet a few people around you. At least greet them. Salaam alaikum. How are you, my brother? How are you, my sister? Etc. etc. It's good. You achieve a reward. There are people around you, right next to you. And sometimes we don't want. It's a blessing that we are sitting here today. Don't you agree? I know the chairs are slightly apart because that's part of our responsibility to ensure that people have a mask on or people are a little bit apart, and to ensure various other things to meet the standard and so on. But it doesn't mean you don't greet, and it doesn't mean you don't get to know one another. So we thank Allah for these blessings. قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِّمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. Say, it is the favor of Allah, the virtue of Allah, what Allah has blessed you with truly. What is it? The mercy of Allah, when He has mercy on you and His virtue upon you, that is what should make you excited. When Allah has blessed you in the true sense, that's what should make you excited, not gathering materialistic items. What they have gathered in terms of materialism is not really a gift unless it comes together with faith and relationship with Allah. So my brothers and sisters, as my time has come to an end, I've spoken for the whole hour. I pray that Allah accept from us this beautiful gathering, and I pray that it's the beginning once again of such gatherings where we can come in and learn from one another, perhaps speak to one another, empower one another to say, don't worry, we're in it together, and we're going to come out together, and we're here for one another, and we're here to tell you, don't worry, the positives far outweigh the negatives. As a believer, for as long as you're getting closer to your Maker, no matter what's happening to you, is actually positive. And so don't worry, take it in your stride, don't lose hope, no matter what's happened to you. Even if you feel today that, you know, I just wish I wasn't alive. There are people who say, I'm suicidal, I wish my life ended. And you just talk to someone and they push you for a day, 2 days, 5 days, a month, 2 months. And after that, you're living such a happy life that you cannot believe that there was a day when you were feeling suicidal. It was not worth it. There is nothing that you should feel suicidal about. Everything is temporary. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all and grant us goodness. May Allah bless this nation and grant us protection. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every one of us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant cure to those who are sick and ill. And may Allah have mercy on those who've passed on. May Allah protect us from the virus, and may Allah eradicate it for us. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد.